and the central pumping organ, that is the heart. So what are the layers of the heart?
Pericardium.
So from outside is pericardium, myocardium and the endocardium. So bacterial infections usually affect the endocardium, whereas the viruses and the mycobacterium tuberculosis affects the myocardium and the pericardium. Especially the pericardium is affected by mycobacterium. It causes tuberculous pericarditis. And the viruses, they affect the myocardium, like coxsackievirus and the other viruses that you will know. So they affect the myocardium. So the bacteria affect the endocardium. So
bacteria can affect all the
rest? The endocardium. So the valves of the heart, you know, the heart has got valves. There are chambers, there are rooms inside the heart. To that rooms you have the doors, and that doors are the valves that control the flow of the blood from one chamber to another chamber. So the valves are part of the endocardium. So the valves are part of the endocardium. So these bacteria, they affect the valves of the heart. The endocardium is the heart valves. The heart valves have got cusps. So these bacteria, they enter the bloodstream. Any bacteria that enters the bloodstream can reach the heart. But some of the bacteria that have the property to attach at high speeds, because the blood flow near the heart is at very high speed, so they have to have very good attaching mechanisms to attach to the heart, because there is very high blood flow. So those bacteria that have got a capsule for attachment, or gram-positive bacteria especially, they have in their cell wall, you remember the man environment block, lipoteichoic acid, and also there is protein F, fibronectin binding protein. These are very strong attaching substances that help the bacteria to attach. And some bacteria, it secretes a glycocalyx, slime-like layer, that also helps in attachment. So bacteria that have got very strong attaching property will attach at very high speeds, because the blood is at very high speeds in the heart. So it attaches to the endocardium of the heart, that is the heart valves. One more property of the feature of these heart valves is that though the endocardium or the heart valves are in direct contact with the blood inside the cavity, but still the blood supply is not from the blood that is inside. The blood supply is coming outside from the coronary arteries. Okay?
Yes, sir.
There is blood inside, but that blood is not giving the blood supply. There is blood inside the heart.
Yes.
That is not part of the blood supply to the endocardium. The blood supply is coming outside. Yes. Though the endocardium and the heart valves are continuously in contact with the blood inside the heart, though that is not for the blood supply. Blood supply is coming from the coronaries, and of all the layers of the heart, the endocardium or the heart valves are the least perfused or having the least blood supply. So this feature helps the bacteria to attach. The immune cells reach, travel through the blood, but if there is very less blood supply to the heart valves, the immune cells cannot reach the bacteria. Not just here, in any case, the organs that have very less perfusion are more likely to have bacterial infections. Wherever there is least blood supply, there is no white blood cells reaching that area, and then they will have bacterial infections. So endocardium of the heart, of all the layers of the heart, are the least perfused, the heart valves. So it helps the bacteria in attachment. Okay? So we have some of the bacteria that more commonly cause affections of the heart, and we have one bacteria in detail, that is Streptococcus pyogenes. So for gram-positive bacteria, you know, we have gram-positive bacteria, streptococci and staphylococci.
Yes.
So these gram-positive bacteria, in their cell wall, all of these have commonly in their cell wall the lipoteichoic acid and the fibronectin binding protein, which helps these bacteria to attach. In streptococci, one streptococci, that is the normal flora or the commensal in the oral cavity, is the Streptococcus viridans. You studied this in the man environment block also. We have the Streptococcus viridans that secretes a slime-like layer, that is the glycocalyx. that helps in the attachment. So this is a normal flora in the oral cavity. So whenever there is a dental procedure, like tooth extraction, or there is any infection of the tooth and there is a dental procedure, so this bacteria can enter from your oral cavity, enter the bloodstream and reach the heart, and in the heart they will attach to the cusps of the valves. The leaflet of the valve is known as cusp.
Yes,
the tricuspid, the bicuspid, the cusp is the leaflet of the valve.
Yes.
So they will attach to the cusp of the valve. So whenever there is dental procedure like tooth extraction, so that is why they give prophylactic antibiotic therapy. Whenever there is a tooth extraction, the dentist will give you a prophylactic antibiotic therapy.
Yes.
To prevent the bacteremia by Streptococcus viridans. So this bacteria will produce the glycocalyx that helps the bacteria in attachment. The adult streptococci is Streptococcus pneumoniae. So this bacteria has got a capsule that is polysaccharide, whereas the Streptococcus pyogenes capsule is hyaluronic acid.
Mm.
And here you have the polysaccharide capsule.
Yes, yes.
And this capsule is, as you know, all like all capsules, they are antiphagocytic. Will not allow the phagocytosis of the bacteria. As you know that the bacteria has got a charge that will attract the neutrophils or the white blood cells towards it, that is chemotaxis, and this capsule will mask that charge, will not allow the charge to be open. So there is no chemotaxis. So that is how this capsule is antiphagocytic. Okay, so here remember that they have capsulated, the capsule is antiphagocytic and the capsule is polysaccharide capsule. Remember these three. Okay. Then you have the cephalococci. So what is, how can you differentiate streptococci from cephalococci?
Those are in chain and the other as well.
Yes, streptococci is in chains, cephalococci are in groups,
yes.
Grape-like clusters. What is one biochemical test that will differentiate streptococci from cephalococci? That is the enzyme specific for Streptococcus pyogenes.
Yes.
I'm talking general about the catalyst. Streptococci.
Catalyst.
Yes, very good. Catalyst. Catalyst is the enzyme, the test that will differentiate Streptococci that are negative. They do not produce that enzyme. And Cephalococci will produce the enzyme catalyst. What is the function of the catalyst? Of? No, catalase, what does it do? Catalase, we did this in the last block, immunodeficiency lecture. Immunodeficiency lectures,
yes,
we talked about there were phagocytic deficiencies.
Yes, yes.
In phagocytic deficiencies, we talked about
granulome.
NADPH oxidase deficiency, yes?
Yes.
What is the function of catalase?
Extraction
of the charge. No, not catalase. Catalase breaks down the hydrogen peroxide.
Yes, there is no intracellular killing.
So catalase will break down the hydrogen peroxide into water and oxygen. So this enzyme differentiates Staphylococci from Streptococci. So in Staphylococci you have another species, aureus, and then you have epidermidis. So aureus is also coagulase positive, produces the enzyme coagulase. What is the function of coagulase?
Coagulase?
Yes.
Coagulation.
No, that is streptokinase. Coagulase, what does coagulase do? Coagulase makes a fibrin wall, converts fibrinogen to fibrin. The girls answered these questions, the same questions. You should also answer this, fibrinogen to fibrin, you don't know this? Coagulase?
Yes, yes.
Yeah, we know what we have. Silent
for that morning. What you should be more active? So the coagulase converts fibrinogen to fibrin and forms a fibrin wall around the bacteria so that the immune cells cannot reach the pathogen. So that is a coagulase enzyme. And also this bacteria, Staph aureus, also has one more virulence factor, that is the protein A in its cell wall. This protein A will bind to the immunoglobulin IgG and prevent the activation of the complement.
Yes.
So there is no complement mediated lysis. So activation of the complement is prevented. And also Staph epidermidis, as you know, it is a normal flora, a commensal of the skin, And if there is any injury to the skin, this bacteria will enter the blood and reach the heart. And this bacteria is coagulase negative. Staph epidermidis infections are more common in people who have got prosthetic valves. What are prosthetic valves?
Artificial
valves. People who have non-functioning valves, in those people, the valves are replaced by artificial valves that are prosthetic valves. In conditions like mitral stenosis and mitral regurgitation, these valves are not functioning, so you replace the valves. So these are the gram-positive cocci. Then you have one spirochete, that is the Borrelia. Borrelia burgdorferi is a spirochete. Which other bacteria are spirochetes? Which other bacteria belongs to this group spirochete?
The one cause syphilis.
Yes, which one?
Pneumonia.
Treponema
pallidum.
Treponema pallidum.
Mm-hmm.
Endocrine reproductive clock.
Yes, that's something.
So, the spirochete, one spirochete is Treponema pallidum. Yes. There is one more spirochete, that is the Leptospira interrogans, and Borrelia. These three are the medically important spirochetes. So there are only three spirochetes. There are many spirochetes, but the spirochetes that cause diseases in the human body, you just have to remember the three. Treponema pallidum that causes syphilis, this Borrelia burgdorferi that causes the Lyme disease, and there's one more, Listeria monocytogenes. Okay, so remember the spirochete. So what do you mean by spirochete?
Spira.
I said Listeria, no, Leptospira. Leptospira enterovirus is another spirochete. Three, you have Treponema pallidum, you have Borrelia burgdorferi, and then you have Leptospira. So what is a spirochete? What do you mean by spirochete?
It's like a thread.
Man environment block?
Yes.
Spiral.
Yes, spiral shape, very good. What are the shapes of the bacteria?
Spiral.
Cocci? Then?
Bicocci.
Diplococci.
No, that is in the cocci. General shape. One is cocci.
Scripto.
Bacilli. Yes, good morning, yes. Bacilli. And then you have spirochete. And what is the fourth group in which there is no specific shape of the bacteria? There was the fourth. Cocci, bacilli, spirochete, and the one group there was no shape of the bacteria, no specific shape. Yes? Welcome back from Dubai, Mohammed. How was Dubai? You have the pleomorphic bacteria.
Yes.
Now back to Sakaka. Dubai is finished. So you have the pleomorphic bacteria that do not have a cell wall and they do not have a specific shape. So Borrelia burgdorferi, this bacteria does not affect the endocardium of the heart. This bacteria causes Lyme disease. In this disease, the conduction system of the heart is affected. So there is no electrical activity that is generated. From where is the electrical activity generated? Where is the impulse started?
SA
node. SA node and goes to AV node and all that, Purkinje fibers, bundle office, all that. So this electrical conduction of the heart is affected. So what happens when the electrical activity is not passing through? So yes, there will be very bradycardia. There is bradycardia. So that is known as the heart block. So that affection of the conductive system of the heart leads to heart block. So this bacteria, spirochete, Borrelia burgdorferi, remember, causes heart block, affects the conduction of the heart, the electrical activity is affected, and there is heart block. Okay. Then you have two gram-negative bacteria, Helicobacter pylori. This you will see more in detail in the GIT block,
yes,
because it more commonly causes gastritis,
yes,
and stomach ulcers, peptic ulcers. So this bacteria enters the blood vessel and causes atherosclerosis. Colonizes the blood vessel, multiplies there, and it affects the blood vessel, so it causes ischemia of the organs. Atherosclerosis and ischemia of the organs, leading to, if it's, there is ischemia of the cerebral arteries, then you have the stroke.
Yeah.
So ischemia of the blood vessels. So, other is the Chlamydia pneumoniae. This bacteria we'll study more in detail in the respiratory block. So here, just remember, it also affects, like Helicobacter pylori, affects the blood vessels, causing atherosclerosis and also ischemia of the organs. For example, in the brain, it causes stroke. Okay?
Yes.
So remember, we have gram-positive bacteria, streptococci and staphylococci. Basically, they cause endocarditis. You have the spirochete, affects the conduction system of the heart, leading to heart clot. You have gram-negative bacteria, affects the blood vessels, causing atherosclerosis and ischemia of the organs. Okay. Then you have these streptococci. So these streptococci here is the Streptococcus pyogenes. So where is this bacteria present? So bacteria, this bacteria is basically present in your throat, in the upper respiratory tract, and it causes more of the respiratory infection. Yes. So the primary infection is the respiratory infection. So after respiratory infection, then it can enter the bloodstream and reach the heart to cause the endocarditis. So basically, this bacteria is more of the respiratory bacteria, but it causes endocarditis, so we have it here. So the structure, as you know, is gram-positive cocci arranged in chains. And this bacteria is fastidious. Fastidious means it has special growth requirements. Like all streptococci are fastidious. They will not grow on ordinary culture media.
Nice.
Like staphylococci. Staphylococci will grow on nutrient agar. Nutrient agar is a special culture media. It's a basic culture media. So streptococci will not grow on basic culture media, so they are fastidious. They will only grow on special culture media, like enriched media, like blood agar. You will see more in the laboratory class. For here, just remember that streptococci are fastidious. They do not grow on ordinary or culture media, and they require carbon dioxide for its growth, like 5 to 10% carbon dioxide, so they are capnophilic. They are capnophilic bacteria. And these bacteria, they do not have flagella, so they are non-motile. And also they are do not produce spores, so they are non-sporing also. And the oxygen requirement, this is a facultative anaerobe. What do you mean by facultative anaerobe?
Grow in the presently oxygen.
Yes, it can grow in oxygen as well as in the absence of oxygen. And there is one chemical, a drug that is known as the bacitracin. So you have many beta-hemolytic streptococci. This bacteria is beta-hemolytic.
Yeah.
So to differentiate between the beta-hemolytic, different beta-hemolytic bacteria, you have the bacitracin. You will see more in this laboratory class. So just remember here that the Streptococcus pyogenes is sensitive, is inhibited by bacitracin, whereas the other beta-hemolytic streptococci, there is one beta-hemolytic streptococci like A. galactiae, that is resistant to bacitracin. Whereas Streptococcus pyogenes is sensitive to bacitracin. Okay. Then the beta hemolytic classification. So there are many beta hemolytic streptococci. So they are classified based on their cell wall. So these streptococci in their cell wall have a carbohydrate that is given the name C, C carbohydrate. So based on that carbohydrate in the cell wall, they are divided into many groups from A, B, C, D, like that. So these are known as the Lansfield groups. Lansfield was a scientist who started this classification. So this is Lansfield groups. These bacteria are divided based on the C carbohydrate in the cell wall. And then you have another protein that is a protein M in their cell wall. So you have C carbohydrate as well as protein M, both in the cell wall. And based on the protein M, they are divided into serotypes. Within the group A, these bacteria divide into serotypes based on the antibodies produced. For each serotype, there's a different antibody.
Yes.
So these are the serotypes. Okay. So they're classified based on the protein M into serotypes. So this Streptococcus pyogenes, it is beta hemolytic, and within the beta hemolytic, it belongs to the group A. So this Streptococcus pyogenes is also known as the group A streptococci. So if you read the textbooks, sometimes you will come across group A streptococci. So it is the same as Streptococcus pyogenes. You are reading the textbooks?
Yes.
Microbiology?
No.
Other.
Physiology.
Not microbiology textbooks?
No.
So group A streptococci is the same as Streptococcus pyogenes. So this is based on the C carbohydrate in the cell wall. Okay? Then the virulence factors. What do you mean by virulence?
Factors which
produce disease. Yes, that helps the bacteria in producing disease and also protects the bacteria from the host immune response. So as we said, outermost, this bacteria has got a capsule. This is a capsulated bacterium. So in Streptococcus, you have Streptococcus pyogenes as well as Streptococcus pneumoniae. Both are capsulated. The capsule of Streptococcus pneumoniae is polysaccharide capsule, whereas the pyogenes, the capsule is hyaluronic acid.
Yes.
And this capsule is antiphagocytic. This hyaluronic acid capsule is antiphagocytic. And also you have, as we said, protein M divides the bacteria into serotypes, and also this protein in the cell wall is antiphagocytic. And also it is part of the bacteria that produces rheumatic fever. That we will see in the other slides about rheumatic fever. So protein M, remember, first of all, helps in classification of the bacteria into serotypes. The second is, it is antiphagocytic. The third point is, it causes rheumatic fever in the body. Okay. Then you have the capsule, that is hyaluronic acid, antiphagocytic. Then you have the cell wall. In the cell wall, you have, because this is gram-positive bacteria, you have the lipoteichoic acid, and also you have the fibronectin binding protein. These two proteins in the cell wall helps the bacteria in attachment, adherence to the endocardium of the heart valves. Okay? Then you have an enzyme that is a C5A peptidase that breaks down the C5A of the complement. Breaks down the C5A complement, so there's no chemotaxis. Yes. Protects the bacteria. Then you have some enzymes that are also called as the invasins, and these enzymes helps the bacteria in spreading. So that is why they are called as the invasins, help the bacteria to move in the tissues. So one of them is the hyaluronidase. You know, the, what do you call it? The surprising feature is that though this bacteria has got a hyaluronic acid capsule, still it produces the hyaluronidase enzyme. Does not affect it, yes. Because it is secreted into the medium, this enzyme, so it is not affecting the capsule of the Streptococcus pyogenes. So this hyaluronidase enzyme breaks down the hyaluronic acid that is present in the connective tissues,
yes.
And also between the cells, intercellular substance, and helps the bacteria to move. So these are the bacteria, so they produce this enzyme, helps the bacteria, separates the cell, yes. And helps the bacteria to move. Another enzyme is the streptokinase. So streptokinase, where is it used?
Myocardium.
Yes, very good, Sultan. How many sultans are there in the class?
Three.
Four.
Where are the other sultans? Where are the other sultans? Sultan means the king.
Yeah,
in Urdu it means the king.
Yes.
So streptokinase is an enzyme produced by this bacteria. It breaks down the fibrin clot. It breaks down the fibrin. So this enzyme works in opposite direction to the coagulase enzyme. Coagulase enzyme was leading to fibrin formation.
Yes.
Fibrinogen to fibrin. This streptokinase will break down the fibrin. Will break down the fibrin. So fibrin is a body's defense mechanism. Produce a wall that will stop the bacteria from moving. So this was the fibrin clot. This is the fibrin clot that was preventing the bacteria from moving. But this bacteria will now produce the streptokinase. And this streptokinase will break down the fibrin and help the bacteria to move. So this is the same streptokinase that is used in medicine in myocardial infarctions. Whenever there is a block, so wherever there is a block in the coronary arteries that supply the heart, whenever there is a block, there is myocardial heart attack. So we use this enzyme streptokinase to break down the clot and relieve the obstruction. So this is where we take the streptokinase from. What is the other drug that you use?
Alteplase.
So Alteplase is more used nowadays because streptokinase is inducing antibodies inside us. So you are not using streptokinase more commonly now. Before it was used more commonly. Now you use the Alteplase. Okay. And there is one more enzyme, that is the DNase or the streptodotinases. When there is bacterial infection, these are pyogenic bacteria. So there is pus formation inside the tissues. So this pus will not allow the bacteria to move easily. What is pus? It is cell debris, cell, the necrotic cells along with the bacteria, epithelial cells and immune cells all together constitute the pus. So this will not help the bacteria to move. So this bacteria will produce another enzyme that is a septodonase. This will break down the cell-free DNA, polymerizes the cell-free DNA, the DNA that is present in the pus. And it will liquefy the pus, make the pus thin,
yes.
And now help the bacteria to move. So streptodonases liquefy the pus, one point. The second is, they also induce antibody formation, they are immunogenic. And that antibodies are used in the diagnosis of this infection. The anti-DNA's antibodies. So when you are sending the blood sample to the laboratory, you order the anti-DNA's antibody. That is specific for Streptococcus pyogenes. So this is also one of the tests and diagnosis, anti-DNA's antibody. Okay? The streptokinase is also known as fibrinolysin because it breaks down the fibrin clot. It is also known as the fibrinolysin. Okay. Then you have the other toxins that are secreted by the bacteria. One of them is that produces a rash. This bacteria produces the toxin that will lead to a red rash. That red is known as the scarlet. Scarlet is one of the shades of red. So that red color is scarlet. So this is the scarlet red rash, and that toxin is erythrogenic toxin. Erythro is red, and genic is production. So the red rash, the shade is scarlet, so this is known as the scarlet red rash. The other toxins are the streptolysins. So you have the streptolysin O and streptolysin S. So one is, the O is oxygen labile, that is, it is broken down in the presence of oxygen, sensitive to oxygen. So it is oxygen labile. And this toxin is immunogenic, will induce antibody formation inside. And these antibodies are also used for diagnosis of this infection. So you have anti-streptolysin O titer. Anti-streptolysin O test, ASO test. That is also used for Streptococcus pyogenes diagnosis. Yes? ASO test. This streptolysin O toxin, yeah, this is also specific for Streptococcus pyogenes. So streptolysin O toxin, one property is that it is oxygen labile, sensitive to oxygen, that is broken down in the presence of oxygen. The second is, for this toxin, our body produces specific antibodies. And these antibodies are used in diagnosis. The antibodies are anti-streptolysin O. The toxin is streptolysin O, so the antibodies are anti-streptolysin O, ASO.
Yeah.
ASO antibodies. And the ASO test is used for diagnosis of this infection. ASO titer or ASO test. And then you have the streptolysin S, and this S is for stable, and this toxin is stable in the presence of oxygen. And this is not immunogenic, though there are no antibodies against it. And the third point is that the beta hemolysis of this bacteria is due to this toxin. The beta hemolysis produced by this bacteria is due to this toxin. Okay. And then you have the other toxins that are the pyrogenic toxins that produce the toxic shock syndrome and the necrotizing fasciitis. What is toxic shock syndrome? Yes, toxic shock syndrome.
Absence of the blood supply.
No, the toxic shock syndrome. We had this in the human immune block also.
No, no.
Yes.
Where?
Think. Go and read the human immune lecture.
Shock meaning absence of the blood supply to the organs. That's
it. Will cause
dysfunction of the organ.
Multi-organ failure, yes, very good.
Yes.
But that is due to hypotension. What is toxic shock syndrome? You don't remember the human immune block?
We studied with you in the musculoskeleton, not in the human immune.
We studied in many places. The latest was the human immune block. We'll see the other slides, okay? So these toxins, remember, pyrogenic exotoxins, you have A and B. One point is they are super antigens. What are super antigens?
induce more response.
Yes, they stimulate a large number of T lymphocytes.
Yes.
That secrete large number of cytokines.
Helps them.
Yes. So that is toxic shock syndrome. And then they cause toxic shock syndrome and necrotizing fasciitis. Okay, we'll see in the other slides what are those. So, as we said, this bacteria is basically part of the upper respiratory tract, causes upper respiratory tract infections, URTIs. And also it is present on the skin. And from there, it spreads to the bloodstream and reaches the heart, attaches by help of its cell wall, lipoteichoic acid and 14F, prevents escape from the host immune response by its capsule, hyaluronic acid capsule, that is antiphagocytic. Protein M is also antiphagocytic. And produces the enzymes and toxins that causes disease. Okay? So what are the infections that are produced? So basically, at the site of attachment, at the site of infection, so the primary infections, the localized infection of this bacteria is part of the upper respiratory tract and the skin. So the primary infection is not the endocarditis.
Yes, yes, yes.
You have the upper respiratory tract infections or the skin infections. So in the upper respiratory tract, what it will cause?
Pharyngitis.
Pharyngitis, tonsillitis, upper respiratory tract infections. So it produces a great thick exudate because it is a pyogenic bacteria, gram positive. It produces a great thick exudate. And they are spread by droplet infection. What are droplets? Droplet. They're spread by droplet infection. Whenever a person is sneezing or coughing, these bacteria travel in small droplets of sputum and they reach another person and cause infection. What are aerosols?
Mud, like in the mud.
Right?
In the mud, in the...
Aerosols. Yes. So what is droplets and what are aerosols?
What are the aerosols of the rain?
Aerosols, it is by coughing.
Yes,
like
very good, but what is it? So it's about the size of the... Size of the particles that we are talking about. If you're coughing and sneezing, the size is very small, it is aerosol. A little larger is droplet nuclei. A little more larger is a droplet. So viruses are very small, they travel in aerosols. Aerosol infection, aerosol transmission. Bacteria larger, they need droplet or droplet nuclei. So you have aerosol, droplet nuclei, droplets. So bacteria, they are larger, so they travel in droplet nuclei or droplet infection. Whereas viruses, they need aerosols. They can travel in aerosols, not bacteria, because they are heavier and larger. Okay? And in the skin, so this bacteria attaches to the skin and causes skin infection. So it produces a red lesion, and that lesion will later on break down, leading to escape of the fluid and the pus. And after some time, these lesions will dry up and they form a scab or a crust. That is different. That is a rash. Here we are talking about impetigo. Uh-huh. Where do you get erythema marginata?
This is
Streptococcus
pyogenes.
Yes.
Yes.
So these red lesions, they break down, and when they break down, they lead to escape of the fluid, and that fluid will heal to form a crust or a scab. So this is impetigo. And when these accompany systemic features and fever, then it is known as erysipelas. So you have impetigo and erysipelas. So when these red lesions break down and the fluid is coming out, these are highly contagious and it can be transmitted from person to person. And when it accompanies fever and systemic toxicity, it is erysipelas. And when these infections go deeper inside by the production of enzymes and toxins, these infections go deeper inside, involving the dermis or subcutaneous tissue, then you have the cellulitis. Okay? If it is only the superficial layers, then it is impetigo. Along with systemic features and fever, it is erysipelas, and then if it involves the deeper layers of the skin, involving the subcutaneous tissue, the dermis, then you have the cellulitis. Okay. Then you have, now the bacteria will spread from the upper respiratory tract or from the skin, reaches and enters a blood vessel. From the blood vessel, it is carried to the heart, attaches to the valves of the endocardium, valves of the heart. So as we said, the valves of the heart have a very poor blood supply, so the immune cells will not reach this heart valve, and the bacteria attaches to the heart valve with the virulence factors that we discussed already. So in people who have heart diseases, pre-existing heart diseases, they will not have a proper blood flow, they will have a turbulent blood flow, not a proper blood flow. So in these people, it is a risk factor. And also in people who have artificial valves, prosthetic valves, this is also a risk factor. So risk factor is, one is people with prosthetic valves and people who have pre-existing heart diseases wherein the blood flow is not proper, it is turbulent blood flow. So in these people, these bacteria attach more easily to the heart valves. And when these bacteria attach, they multiply and they form a colony. And that is known as a vegetation. So vegetation is the multiplication and the growth of the bacteria into a colony, is known as a vegetation. So what happens? So there's inflammation. And then there is an inflammation of the heart valves, that is endocarditis. The immune cells will come, and then the bacterial infection, the vegetation, will lead to infective endocarditis. So what will happen if there's inflammation and then there is vegetation on the cusp of the heart valve? It will not work. So you will have all this mitostenosis. Mitostenosis is the thickening of the valve. And if it is not functioning, then it is regurgitation. You know the difference between stenosis and regurgitation?
Yes.
Stenosis is the thickening. If it is not opening, it is stenosis.
Narrowing
and not opening is stenosis. Thickened, stiff is stenosis. It's not opening. And if it is not working properly, it is allowing the backflow of the blood, it is regurgitation. So all this can happen. Then you have the toxins. So as we said, the pyrogenic neurotoxins will produce a toxic shock syndrome. This toxin will act as a superantigen, will stimulate a large number of T cells, T lymphocytes, which in turn will produce large number of cytokines. And they will cause fever, hypotension, decreased blood pressure, hypotension, leading to multi-organ failure. So that is toxic shock syndrome.
Mm-hmm.
Which other bacteria can produce toxic shock syndrome? Staph aureus and Streptococcus pyogenes. So the other toxin is the pyrogenic exotoxin that causes necrotizing fasciitis. So Streptococcus pyogenes is one of the two bacteria that causes very severe cellulitis and skin infection. One is Streptococcus pyogenes, other is Clostridium perfringens. Both these bacteria, they cause very severe cellulitis and necrotizing fasciitis. When the cellulitis goes more deeper inside, involves the muscle and the bones, then it is necrotizing fasciitis, involving the fascia, muscle and the bones. Okay? That is necrotizing fasciitis. Cellulitis, when it goes more deeper inside, becomes necrotizing fasciitis. So because of this, this bacteria is also known as the flesh-eating bacteria. Okay? And the other toxin was, as we said already, is the erythrogenic toxin that produces a red rash. Scarlet red rash. So it is scarlet fever. Okay, then the last topic is the immunopathology. So here the bacteria itself is not causing the disease, but the immune response to the bacteria is causing the pathogenesis.
Yeah.
So there are two entities here. One is the glomerulonephritis and the other is the rheumatic fever. So these two are not directly due to the bacteria, but they are due to the immune response. What type of hypersensitivity was there in
two,
the MEQ?
Two.
Yes.
What was the case in the MEQ? It was autoimmune hemolytic anemia.
Yes.
The patient had SLE, that is a different story, forget about it. The case was autoimmune hemolytic anemia.
Yes.
What was the hypersensitivity? Type 2?
Type 2, yes.
Why students write type 3?
The light, type 3.
So it was type 2, okay? So here there are two entities. One is the rheumatic fever. You write type 3?
No, I said both.
There is the same reduction in the SLE. The antibodies directly go and attack the myosin of the heart and causes carditis. So rheumatic fever is type 2 and glomerular nephritis is type 3. The antigens of the streptococci, they combine with the antibodies and these immune complexes go and settle in the basement membrane of the glomeruli and cause lead to inflammation, complement activation, and then neutrophils, proteases lead to glomerular nephritis. So glomerular nephritis is type 3 and rheumatic fever is type 2. And they accompany the skin infection or the upper respiratory tract infection. So you have the first the infection, for example, of the upper respiratory tract, and the patient becomes normal. Then after 2 to 3 weeks, he develops rheumatic fever or he can develop the glomerular nephritis. So what are the features of glomerular nephritis? He will have blood in the urine, he will have edema, puffy face like that, hypertension. So there is first infection and the bacteria will disappear, and after incubation period of 2 to 4 weeks or sometimes 3 weeks, and these secondary infections will develop due to the immune response of the body. One of these, the rheumatic fever, it is recurrent. So for that rheumatic fever, you need to give long-term penicillin prophylaxis.
Yes.
But for glomerular nephritis, this is not required because it is not recurrent. The immune complexes. Okay. So for rheumatic fever, you need to give long-term penicillin prophylaxis because it is recurrent. Okay. This clear? There are different strains. As we said, there are 80 strains. So there are different strains for rheumatic fever and different for glomerular nephritis. But you don't need to remember the numbers. Don't learn the numbers. Just remember that the strains, the serotypes are different that lead to rheumatic fever and that lead to glomerular nephritis. Okay? That's clear?
Yeah.
What did you write for Epstein-Barr virus?
What's the question?
Epstein-Barr virus.
Epstein-Barr virus. Mode of transmission.
There were two. Kissing.